Hey folks, this is Shock, and we're going to do another Bible study. This one's going to be epic. This is another Bible study in our continuing series titled, Things Jesus Said That May Shock You. And not only are we going to talk about things that Jesus said that may shock you, we're going to talk to you about things that he's going to do in the future that will shock you. And before we do this, as always, I have some free goodies for you guys. Go to shockanow.net, notice on the top right-hand corner of this page, or just click in the video description below. It'll take you there. And we have 18 people at this site right now, as you can see here. If you click this where it says 18 online, you'll go into a live chat room where people are chatting about the important topics of the day. You can also look at some of these Bible studies here from within a church, epic Bible studies. But what I really want you to do is scroll down here, and let's see if I can find it here. And what I want you to get is this right here, free audio Bible. And also visit our free stuff area. We have so many free things for you guys. You know why we give them to you free? Because we love you guys. We want you to be equipped for these trials that are coming to our world. You know, the more I talk to people, the more other people are saying, man, this world is going nuts. It seems like it's getting crazier and crazier as time goes by. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Things Jesus said that will shock you, and also some things that he's going to do. Now, you know, I think a lot of folks may be timid or shy about getting into some of the information I'm about to get into with you here in the Bible. But I remember just recently I was listening to the radio, and a pastor was on the radio, and he said something, and it was so true, but it's shocking. He said, you know, when Jesus came the first time, he came as an innocent little baby, and he grew up into a man, and he was meek and just very gentle, and he came and he healed people, and he died for the sins of the world so that you and I could be saved. But what's going to happen, what you're going to notice in the future, is what happens is the world gets more and more evil. And it actually shows in Scripture that the world becomes very demonic, where people actually willingly, knowingly follow Satan. We used to think that, oh, come on, who would be so stupid as to do that? And now even they have websites, and people are even here on YouTube that will openly, willingly admit that they worship Satan. So we used to think it was crazy, but now it's just out there in the open, and you're going to see more and more that the world drifts towards that. What's amazing, though, is this pastor was talking about how the next time Jesus comes, he's coming to kill people. He's going to go to war against Satan and his armies. So he's coming to kill. And he is going to come back as a warrior leading an army to go to war against Satan's army. And Satan's going to have a huge, massive army. And, you know, as politically incorrect as it is, Jesus will come back in Revelation. I'm going to read it to you. And he is going to kill. And so it's just interesting that he comes in the beginning. He's born as a baby. He is meek, and he's loving, and he's caring, and he's healing people. But the world rejects him at that time as the Messiah. What you're going to see here in Revelation, when you go to Revelation, is the world embraces the Antichrist as Messiah. So it's interesting that Jesus was rejected. He was crucified. But God was able to use this in his plan of redemption for you and I and forgiveness of our sins. But when the Antichrist comes, the world is going to be enamored with him, and they actually embrace him. And in fact, the Antichrist claims that he is the Prince of Peace of the world. He's going to be Talking Peace. And don't forget, when the Bible study is done, look below this video to go to shotgunnow.net, and I'd like you to see and hear the lyrics of the song that Johnny Cash had written, because I think it's very apropos for what we're going to go through. Now, we're going to be reading from Revelation. A lot of times people call it Revelations. It's Revelation, and that stands for the unveiling. Sort of like if you were to create an artistic statue and you hide it behind a curtain, and then all of a sudden the audience is there and you're going to unveil this statue, this beautiful artistic statue that you created, and you unveil it. And Revelation is the unveiling. And we're going to read this to you. I'm going to read some parts to you. It is fascinating because the Bible is the only book in the world that dares to prophesy the future and gets it right 100% of the time. Just for example, the Bible prophesied that Israel would be gathered again to herself as a nation. You know, no other country has done that in world history. But in 1948, ladies and gentlemen, prophecy came true. I have some friends of mine that were unbelievers at the time, and just the miraculous gathering of Israel again to herself is proof and evidence that the Bible deserves respect and it deserves our attention. But now what we're seeing in society as we move towards a new world order and globalization rears its evil head, we're noticing the world is different, isn't it? It's really different. And we're going to be moving towards a one-world monetary system. So let's get into this, and let's talk about some of the shocking things that Jesus Christ said and some things that he's going to do. Revelation 1 says, "The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants, things which must shortly take place. And he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, to all things that he saw. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near." So what's really interesting is here you have a promised blessing right here in Revelation. You are blessed to educate yourself on this and to read it and to hear it. So here you have a blessing, and I hope this blesses you. So we're going to now go with me to Revelation 19. I want to show you this. It says, "Heaven exalts over Babylon. After these things I heard a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, Hallelujah, salvation and glory and honor and power belong to the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments, because he has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth with her fornication, and he has avenged on her the blood of his servants shed by her." Again they said, Hallelujah. So John's seeing this, okay? "Her smoke rises up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshipped God who sat on the throne, saying, Amen, Alleluia. Then a voice came from the throne saying, Praise our God, all you his servants and those who fear him, both small and great." Now, as you scroll on down here, remember we talked about how when Jesus Christ returns, he's coming back to kill. He's coming back with righteous anger to go to war against a very evil army. And it's Satan's armies. So this is, I know, politically incorrect to say that when Jesus returns in Revelation, he's coming back to kill. And some people are afraid to talk about this. I think what we have to do as Christians is preach the whole gospel. And it would be dishonest of us to not talk about what's going to happen when Jesus Christ returns to people that are on the wrong side. So it's important that, you know, we choose sides. So notice John sees this. He says, I saw heaven open and behold a white horse. And he who sat on him was called faithful and true. And look what he does. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. And notice he is capitalized, signifying divinity here. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except, look, himself, capitalized. Now, this is fascinating what I'm going to show you here. He was clothed, notice, with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should, notice, strike the nations. And he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. Now guys, this is sweet, gentle, meek, loving Jesus from the New Testament that is returning to take back a world that is now gone crazy and is actually following after Satan. Now I'm going to show you something interesting. Notice what it says here. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. There is no way you can get around saying this isn't Jesus Christ. This is sweet, gentle, meek, loving Jesus coming back as a warrior. Notice he judges and makes war right here in this verse 11 here, 19:11. Now, where else did we hear this phrase? If you guys like to read scripture, I'm sure you've read this in Isaiah. Look, he himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. Now, when I have to tell you something, when I was a new believer and I wasn't really educated on scripture, and we know we're always educating ourselves, of course, but I mean, I was really like, I had just left the madness of atheism and had become a Christian, and I embraced reason and sanity in Jesus Christ, and I left the madness of atheism. I remember reading this, however, when it says he has a robe dipped in blood, and I thought that that was Jesus' own blood that he shed on the cross, but it's not. What you're seeing here, ladies and gentlemen, is an epic portrait of a warrior. Sometimes you can see these warriors, let's say in World War II, you'll see these United States soldiers, and they just fought against the evil armies of Hitler, and they're lying there on the battlefield exhausted, and their uniforms are stained with the blood of their enemies. And what you're seeing here is an epic picture of Jesus Christ judging and making war, and he's battling very evil people. So go with me now to Isaiah 63. This was written before Jesus was here on earth in the flesh. This is from the Old Testament. Look what it says. It says, who is this who comes from Edom? And notice it's talking about how his garments are dyed. D-Y-E-D, like it's a different color. It says, this one who is glorious in his apparel. Look at the word his. It's capitalized. Traveling in the greatness of his strength. I who speak in righteousness, mighty to save. Notice what it says here in Isaiah. There's a question here. Why is your apparel red? You see what's happening here in Isaiah. There's a question. Why is your apparel red? There's this figure, this person who is coming, and he's traveling, notice, in greatness and of his strength. And it says, I who speak in righteousness, mighty to save. These epic words, almost poetic. And notice there's a question here, but why is your apparel red? Why is your apparel red and your garments like one who treads in the winepress? And then it goes on, this very poetic, this scripture here. Notice what it says. I have trodden the winepress alone, and from the peoples no one was with me. For I have trodden them in my anger and trampled them in my fury. Their blood, notice, is sprinkled upon my garments. And I have stained all my robes, for the day of vengeance is in my heart, and the year of, look at this, my redeemed has come. I looked, but there was no one to help, and I wondered that there was no one to uphold. So what's happening here is the world's gone crazy. It's getting more and more evil. And notice he's saying, I look, but there was no one to help, and I wonder that there was no one to uphold. Therefore, my own arm brought salvation for me, and my own fury it sustained me. I have trodden down the peoples in my anger, made them drunk in my fury, and brought down their strength to the earth. So let's go back. Notice that's very similar to what we're seeing here in Revelation here. I'm sorry. Here we go, right here. I'm jumping ahead of you here. We're going to go to here, Revelation 20 in a second, but this is very similar to what we just read here. Notice, he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God, and the armies of heaven clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. And here it is. Isn't this almost word for word in a way similar to what Isaiah was saying? He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And notice what it says on his robe and on his thigh, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the birds that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather together for the supper of the great God, that you may eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and those who sit on them, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, both small and great. Now look at this. And I saw the beast, the kings of the earth, this is Satan's armies here, and their armies gathered together to make war against him who sat on the horse and against his army. This is the ultimate battle of evil, right here, versus good. Then the beast was captured. So during this war, this battle, the beast is captured, evil loses, and with him the false prophet who works signs in the presence by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast. They're talking about this mark, as you know, is 666 or 616, and those who worshipped his image. So what's happening here? Notice, then the beast was captured with him the false prophet, and he's talking about by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worship the image. What happens to these two guys? These two were cast alive into the lake of fire burning with brimstone. Well, what happens to the rest of the armies? These are human armies that are following the beast, the false prophet also. What happens to them? Look, and the rest were killed with the sword which proceedeth from the mouth of him who sat on the horse, and all the birds were filled with their flesh. Guys, this is sweet, gentle, meek Jesus. Listen, this is Jesus, but when he's coming back, he ain't going to be sweet and meek and gentle to the people that are following Satan. He is coming back to tread the winepress. Now notice it says, and the rest were killed with the sword which proceedeth from the mouth of him. And the Bible uses a lot of poetic language. And so when it says sword, anyone that even like, if you have like a basic understanding of scripture, what does the sword symbolize? The word of God. So notice Jesus is going to open his mouth. He's going to say something. Doesn't say what he says. He might just say, hey, you've had it, or, you know, enough, you know, but he's going to say something and it just wipes them out, totally decimates them. Now let's go to Revelation 20. It talks about this 1,000-year reign of Christ here. It says, then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. And he cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him so that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years were finished. But after these things, he must be released for a little while. So when people say things like these phrases, like, oh, it's the end of the world, the end of the world's almost here, we haven't even gone through the 1,000-year reign of Christ yet. You see that? And there are some people that say, oh, well, you know, Satan's already cast it, you know, into the bottomless pit. Well, I would say if that's the case, then you the chain's too long because this world is pretty evil. No, Satan is alive and well. Scripture talks about when God questions Satan, what have you been doing? He says he's been going up and down the earth, sort of like a lion, you know, stalks its prey, walking up and down the earth. But this is really interesting here, and we're going to talk about this 1,000-year reign of Christ. And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the word of God. So what's going to happen is this Antichrist, this false prophet, the beast, they basically attack the followers of Jesus Christ. And if you don't worship Satan, you don't take his mark, then the punishment is beheading. So there are people like you and I that would say, hey, to hell with the mark. I'm not taking it. Take my head. I'm not taking it. I'm not going to take the mark. There will be people that are willing to be beheaded, you know. Not something that I would look forward to, but, you know, I'm not going to take the mark. If you take the mark, then you are definitely in a worse state than if you lost your head. Because look what it says. It says, the people that had not received the mark on their foreheads or on their hands. So he's seeing their souls. John is seeing their souls, okay? And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead did not live again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power. So what happens is when you die, okay, that's the first death. And when you're judged, if you're not saved, then there's a second death for you. But if you are saved, notice it says, over such the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Okay, now, let's mosey on here to the great white throne judgment. You don't want to be at the great white throne judgment. This is where the enemies of Christ go. Then I saw a great white throne, and him who sat on it, who from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And notice, anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Now, people want to know what heaven's going to be like. It says, now I saw a new heaven and a new earth. So it's interesting. The earth is renewed. We have a new earth. It's probably going to be all war-torn and everything, and nuclear bombs and, smoldering rubble all over the place. Similar to like the Terminator movies, So we could have a new earth, a new heaven. And it's interesting, it says there's no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Then he who sat on the throne said, so this is what you can take to the bank here. They're saying, look, you can trust this. Behold, I make all things new. And he said to me, write, for these words are true and faithful. True and faithful. Now, if you want to know how the Bible ends, it's this page here. This is the last phrases of the Bible here. It says, for I testify to everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book, if anyone adds to these things, God will add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And if anyone takes away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part from the book of life, from the holy city, and from the things which are written in this book. So we're not allowed to like write things in, add things in, and we're not allowed to take things away from the book. You want to accept the whole book of Revelation. He who testifies to these things says, surely I am coming quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. And to that we say, Maranatha. So it's going to be awesome. Don't forget to visit shakanow.net, guys. We've been spending a lot of time updating this site for you. Don't forget to read Hebrews 2:3. I always put like little secret messages here for you. But I want to show you something else. Here's my buddy Carl Gallups. He's got a radio show there. He's a best-selling author. You can go to our videos page, our links page, our calendar of events page. But I'll show you a little secret. If you hold your mouse here where it says more, see how all that pops up there? And if you have a scroll wheel on your mouse, scroll down. You can watch the entire movie of Passion of the Christ. You can get some free audiobooks. Listen to me in debate. Always exciting. Free audiobooks, Bible Contradictions Debunked. You can read about the Illuminati. Excellent audios here, our Christian chat network here. Let's see what else we got. You could enter our chat, whoops, enter our chat room here, and then definitely you could download some MP3s here also. Let's see what else. Oh, my buddy Tally for God, also on YouTube. Check that out. If you want to listen to me on the radio, where we take live callers, you never know what they're going to say when they call in. Listen to Shock Radio. So God bless you guys. I love you. Don't forget to stop by here and check out all this stuff. You'll like this too, these live preachings from church. And as always, make sure that as you wake up each day in this crazy world we live in, make sure that you have on this right here, the full armor. Have a great week.